job. Yep, the 6th, 7th, and 11th.
Hey, how are you?
Good. I'll call on him to resign.
And Debbie, you'll repeat that information when we start at 11, right?
I'm not going to do it. Derek, can you repeat when somebody repeat that the 6th, 7th, and 11th congressional districts pass the resolution calling on Ralston to resign at the district conventions?
I have a lot of material to go through.
Oh, so he won't. But we can do it afterwards.
Thank you,
just
Debbie.
Just because there's so much.
Okay. Speaker.
Question, is there anyone actually streaming the entire thing?
We have. Are you going to too,
Tim? I was going to, but I didn't bring the right equipment to do it.
Oh, okay. I think William Perry's going to.
Maybe 10 minutes.
Yeah, it's going to see you.
Microphone down so it's not in front of your face.
Hey. going to be a hero, Derek.
It's not the intent of this effort.
He's all up to hear what Cheryl, one of the big ones.
Cheryl.
I'm here. I just said you're already my hero.
It's just because you don't know me better.
Where's Nydia? Okay, I'm live streaming it. We're going to be sending the link.
Okay, you're going to live stream it? Send it to... Or get my phone, Debbie at Energy Drink. USA. Or you can just text me.
I'm not on here. All right, you got it.
This will be much better. We'll share it on my Facebook.
Good morning. My name is David Clark, and I'm the chairman of the Interstate Cooperations Committee in the Georgia House of Representatives. I'm here today to share with you information that clearly shows Speaker David Ralston has abused his position and prevented dozens of Georgians, perhaps hundreds, from having their day in court. He did it by relying on a state law that was originally designed to minimize interference between court proceedings and legislative sessions. He exploited and manipulated this state law in a way that reasonable people would find reprehensible. The evidence you will hear in a moment shows an alarming and overwhelming pattern of abuse of power. David Ralston used his power as Speaker to abuse the right to justice of many alleged victims. He fashioned his power into a business model to enrich himself with little effort other than sending off hundreds of letters requesting special treatment from judges. This special treatment is based upon a gross usage of what is termed legislative leave. Lawyers in the legislature are allowed by state law to utilize it when legitimate. Pressing legislative duties prevent them from appearing in court on behalf of their clients. Other lawyers I know in the legislature use this request in the most restrained manner, using it as a tool or a tactic to support a lucrative business model or enterprise is not legitimate. In fact, it's just plain wrong. I stand here today with Derek Somerville, a former FBI agent, and I want to emphasize his research into this issue shows a deep and broad pattern that goes far beyond what was previously revealed in the press. Derek and I have several things in common. We met on the campaign trail working as veterans in support of Governor Kemp's election. We both learned about this issue in February from the AJC news article. Finally, he and I shared background through our commitment to our country as veterans with combat service. I do not want to be here. I'd prefer to be focused on my wife and daughter, my small business, constituents, and duties as a House chairman. I'm an unlikely person to be standing here. Speaker Ralston appointed me as a new chairman in January. which makes this painful because I would truly prefer to work as a team with a speaker and a caucus for the best interests of all Georgians. As you know, I signed a resolution along with a few others in February calling for Speaker Ralston's resignation as Speaker. Let me be clear. There are more Republican caucus members deeply troubled by his action, but they want to continue to make a difference and have not come forward because of their commitment to their constituents' concerns. Concerns that would languish when retribution came, as it surely would if they acted. I want you to know I respect and support the representatives that signed the resolution as well as those that did not. Some of the few representatives that signed the resolution remind me of the few that supported David Ralston in 2009 when he unsuccessfully challenged the previous speaker over concerns with how he handled the position. They too were then marginalized. I'm standing here because it matters how the Georgia Speaker conducts his private and public affairs. The person who holds the position must conduct himself in an ethical and transparent manner and be held to the highest standard. Before I turn it over to Derek, I want to call again on David Ralston to resign as Speaker because Georgia deserves better. His resignation would also free up time to actively represent his clients as a lawyer and allow fellow Georgians awaiting justice to have their day in court. Thank you, and now a hand over to Derek.
Thank you, David. As David indicated, my name is Derek Somerville. I am a resident of Georgia and have been for 15 years. I'm a Georgia business owner, a veteran of the Marine Corps, and somewhat relevant to the matter before us today, in the early 2000s, I served as an FBI special agent. I am not an elected official. I've never held elected office. I have no plans of ever holding elected office. Further, in no way have my efforts been guided by or directed by any elected official. I'm simply a citizen who believes the people of Georgia deserve to hold a conversation about the speaker's conduct that is based not only on his explanation of his actions, but on the public's unfettered access to the facts. It's that conversation I hope to contribute to today. As a matter of background, a little over 2 months ago, I read Johnny Edwards' story in the AJC, and I watched Tony Thomas's reporting on WSB TV about Speaker David Ralston's use of legislative leave. I, like so many Georgia citizens, was shocked. I was outraged and, frankly, in disbelief that any one individual had the power to unilaterally dictate when they, and by extension, when their clients, would or would not appear in court. I, like so many others, was shocked to learn that without any apparent oversight or controls, an elected official might actually have the ability to unilaterally bring the wheels of justice to an abrupt and often painful halt with a simple stroke of just a pen. I didn't believe it, and thus I decided to go look into the allegations myself. What started as a simple visit to the Gilmer County Courthouse ultimately resulted in hundreds of miles driven, 8 county courthouses visited, many several times, nearly 1,000 case files reviewed, several thousand court documents read, and over 1,600 documents copied and recorded, all of which are before you today. The more I looked, the more I found. And it didn't take long to discover that the largest numbers that had been reported to the public that Ralston had delayed as many as 66 cases with 202 continuances was just the tip of a very large and complex iceberg. Before I begin, I want to make a couple things very clear. I'm also not a lawyer. I have no expertise with legal proceedings, and as such, I encourage those who do to review this information. It's very possible that I missed something. Additionally, I want to point out that all of the information contained in my findings was sourced strictly from publicly available records retained by Superior Court clerks. Following an exhaustive review of Speaker Ralston's case documents stored in 8 North Georgia counties, Gilmer, Fannin, Union, Pickens, Cherokee, Dawson, Towns, and Lumpkin, to date, I have discovered and documented 1,091 legislative leave continuances spanning 279 civil and criminal cases. 966 of those continuances have occurred since Ralston became Speaker of the House.
577, or 53% of those appear to have occurred outside of regular and special legislative sessions, and the 3 weeks following both as allowed for by the law. I want to stress that these numbers are likely low. And as others continue to investigate, and I hope they will, it's reasonable to expect that these numbers will climb. There are still unchecked counties where the speaker practices law. Unchecked counties where he has no question had legislative leave continuances. And it's clear that court records do not consistently contain documentation for every continuation that was asked for or granted. I also believe there are many instances where legislative leave was requested and granted simply over the phone. From these 1,091 continuances, I calculate that the speaker requested and received approximately 722 working days of leave outside of regular session, outside of special sessions, and outside of the 3 week period following. As with the continuances, I believe it's safe to assume that the actual number of days leave is likely to be higher than this figure. As an example of the impact Ralston's use of legislative leave had on the days he left himself to tend to his legal caseload, court documents indicate that last year, 2018, after taking no less than 89 days of legislative leave outside of the general and special session, and after accounting for state holidays, Speaker Ralston left himself with only 87 working days and only three intact weeks, that's five full days, to accommodate court orders to appear, to respond to discovery requests, and generally to tend to his caseload obligations. But as you can see, from this 10-year map of his legislative leave days, there are prior year examples where the speaker left himself with even fewer days than he did last year. Though not my focus, as a byproduct of recording and mapping the actual days that the speaker requested off in his legislative leave letters, I identified at least a half a dozen instances in which the speaker certified to the court he was required to be, quote, in attendance at a session of the General Assembly during periods after the session he cited had already adjourned and after the 3 week period following had concluded. For example, in this February 3rd, 2015 letter, Ralston states regarding the day of May 4th, 2015, quote, I anticipate being in the 2015 session of the General Assembly at that time or being within the 3 week period from the final adjournment. The session actually ended on April 2nd, and the 3 week window following actually ended on April 25th. Perhaps this is just a simple mistake. And I share instances such as this not to nitpick at the speaker's accuracy when certifying his commitments to the court, though I do think it's important to be truthful and accurate in what he certifies to judges. I share this to point out that at no time does it appear that the judges who received these inaccurate continuances ever checked, ever questioned, or ever objected to the dates in Ralston's letters. Examples of similar inconsistencies were revealed as well, intended or otherwise, in which the speaker appears to issue contradictory reasons for requiring continuances from multiple courthouses on the same dates. One such example involves a March 3rd, 2014 letter Ralston submitted to Judge Gunter in Union County requesting a legislative leave continuance for the week of April 14th through the 18th, indicating he would be required to be in attendance at the 2014 legislative session on those dates and, quote, for a period of time thereafter, unquote. As an aside, the session actually concluded on March 20th, and the 3 week period after adjournment actually ended April 10th. So this one was inaccurate as well. But roughly 1 month later, in an April 4th, 2014 notice of leave of absence letter to, quote, all judges, clerks of court, and counsel of record, unquote, Ralston advises he will be away from the practice of law from April 15th, 2014 through May 23rd, 2014 for, quote, political campaign, unquote. Incidentally, that's 39 calendar days, and in that letter he referenced 66 of his cases. These two letters ultimately suggest that for the period of April 15th through April 18th, Ralston certified to the courts that he was required to be in attendance at a legislative session, but advised in a separate letter that during the same period of time, he would be engaged in, quote, political campaign. This contradiction also does not appear to have been questioned by the court. Related, I discovered multiple instances where the speaker didn't request a day or a week of legislative leave, as I believe many understood it was intended for, but rather extended periods of time spanning several weeks and even several months. One compelling example can be found in Ralston's November 22, 2016 letter to Judge Weaver, in which Ralston informs the court, and I quote, "I will be on legislative leave beginning November 21, 2016 in preparation for the 2017 session of the Georgia General Assembly. I hereby certify to the court, pursuant to this code section, that my legislative duties will require that I be elsewhere each of the dates beginning with that date through the final adjournment of the session." Let me clarify. Ralston, through this letter, informed the court he was taking the period of November 16, 2016 through March 31st, 2017. That 131-day period included out-of-session legislator leave for at least 6 weeks in 2016 and the first six working days of 2017. These are some of the high-level examples of what the data yielded, but I'd like now to take a slightly deeper dive and reconcile some of the remarks Speaker Ralston made before the House on February 22nd of this year with the records that I'm sharing with you today. First, I'd like to address Mr. Ralston's statement to the Assembly that, quote, "not all continuances were requested by me," unquote. While this may be factually correct, indeed opposing counsel did request continuances, this appears to be a terribly misleading statement. There's no doubt that other attorneys requested and received continuances in trials where they were opposing counsel to Ralston. I saw them. They were requests for continuances that predominantly were based on family vacations and medical appointments, and also included case conflict announcements in instances where they had multiple cases scheduled for court on the same day. But compared to the nearly 1,100 requests that I documented from Ralston, opposing counsel delays amounted to little more than a drop in his legislative leave bucket. While I did not calculate the actual ratio, I estimate Ralston received between 5 and 10 times the number of continuances as the opposing counsel in all his cases combined. Ralston also stated, "As a lawyer, I have zero control over a court calendar." The facts overwhelmingly confirm that when it came to his cases, the only person who appeared to have true control over the court's calendar was not the judge, was not opposing counsel, was not the prosecution, and was certainly not the victims. That distinction belongs solely to David Ralston. Remember, each and every legislative leave continuance the speaker requested was in response to the court attempting to get him into court for calendar calls, motions and appeals, and trials. And while he might respond that he was able only to tell the court when he could not attend, but was not able to set dates himself, I discovered at least one incident that suggests otherwise.
Derek, can you explain that? What do you mean that Mr. Ralston is the one who controlled the calendar and not the judge?
Do you mind if I come back to that at the conclusion?
Sure.
Thank you. In a December 28th letter to Judge Jason Deal, to Speaker Ralston, Judge Deal writes, quote, "The above case has been on the court's calendar for a revocation hearing several times, and due to Mr. Ralston's legislative duties, hearings have been continued," unquote. Judge Deal further instructs Ralston, quote, "In light of this, the court is going to leave the revocation hearing pending, and the defendant will remain in jail until such time that Ralston contacts this office to schedule a hearing," unquote. Incidentally, it's not evident that Ralston ever did schedule a hearing, as he appears to have delayed that trial into the next year before withdrawing as counsel with his client still remaining in custody. Also, when addressing the legislature, Ralston stated, quote, "Not one time in all my legal career, particularly during the period beginning in 2010, has a judge or a prosecutor in the circuits which I practice questioned my need for legislative leave," unquote. Unfortunately, the facts and amount of documented court records don't appear to support this statement. The most poignant and unreported example being when, on October 7th of 2015, David Ralston, the Speaker of the Georgia House of Representatives, was held in contempt of court by Judge Stanley Gunter in Towns County for, quote, "willful disobedience of this court's order granting plaintiff motion to compel discovery," unquote. Ralston was threatened with arrest. Let me reiterate that. The Speaker was threatened with arrest by the court if he did not comply with the court's order within 10 days. At a high-level summary, citing his legislative duties as the cause, for over 2 years, Ralston ignored opposing counsel's efforts and the court's lawful orders to respond to discovery. Given the severity of this incident, I'd like to take a bit of a deeper dive here. In an April 21st, 2015 sworn affidavit supporting his motion to compel Ralston and Ralston's client to comply with court ordered discovery, attorney Thomas Richelieu detailed more than 2 years and more than 10 attempts to get Ralston to comply with court ordered discovery, concluding, quote, "I have never received an email, phone call, letter, or any other form of direct communication from Ralston." As I will share later in this presentation, this pattern of Ralston's behavior repeated itself frequently in other cases, both before and after his order of contempt. In his motion to compel, also dated April 21st, 2015, Mr. Richelieu stated, quote, "Plaintiff notes that Attorney Ralston is the Speaker of the Georgia House of Representatives and as such is entitled to leave of absence during legislative terms and other times of official House of Representatives duty. However, Attorney Ralston has not returned or responded to numerous communications from counsel's plaintiff spanning a period of more than 2 years," unquote. On or about June 17th of 2015, Ralston's client, presumably through Ralston, was served with the court's order to comply with request for discovery. Despite being given 14 days by the court to respond, Ralston took 20. Richelieu described Ralston's response as breaking, quote, "a silence of almost 2.5 years. In his July 7th letter, to Mr. Richelieu, Ralston stated, quote, "Please accept, even at this point, my apology and regrets at not being in communication with you. As you may be aware, I'm in my law office on a very limited basis, given my other obligations," unquote. Ralston went on to state, "Although it is outside the time frame ordered by the court, I would propose to have these responses to you by July 31st, 2015. I have only 4 weekdays and 2 weekend days available in my law office during the remainder of this month, but we'll see that compliance is had if you see it fit to honor this request." Incidentally, my examination of Ralston's continuances show he had 10 weekdays, not 4 as he stated, remaining in July of 2015 as of the time of this letter. Despite his commitment, Ralston again failed to comply with the order of the court. In a July 30th letter, drafted the day before he had previously committed to completing the court ordered discovery, Ralston informed Mr. Richelieu, quote, "I will be out of town at a meeting the week of August 3rd. However, we are endeavoring to get this information to you upon return the week of August 10th, unquote. Perhaps explainable, but worth noting here again that none of the 1,091 continuances that I recorded and reviewed indicated to any court that Ralston was unavailable the week of August 3rd, 2000, and I believe that is 15. Mr. Richelieu, like many other attorneys that I will discuss later in my presentation, had justifiably had enough. And on August 20th, 2015, he filed a formal motion of contempt to hold Speaker Ralston and his client in contempt. In his motion, Mr. Richelieu states, quote, "With members of the legislature as counsel, There is a risk that serial continuances can delay a plaintiff's case against a representative's client indefinitely, unquote. Richelieu went on to state, quote, a basis exists to find Attorney Ralston himself fallen below the required standard of deference to the orders of the court. Ralston, not his client, is the officer of the court, unquote. Richelieu went on to state, quote, plaintiff must also address the issue of Ralston's service as Speaker of the Georgia House of Representatives. As noted in this case previously, plaintiff has given Mr. Ralston extraordinary deference as a consequence of his legislative role. However, Mr. Ralston himself acknowledges that legislative duties take up a large amount of his time. It follows that Mr. Ralston, by his own admission, is only equipped to take on limited caseload. It is presumed that he does just that. In that sense, his situation is no different from that of any other very busy attorney who faces the demands of multiple cases or clients. As an officer of the court, Mr. Ralston's duties include determining when and if he does not have sufficient time to adequately fulfill the requirements of a particular case. Finally, Mr. Richelieu states, this is an important opportunity for the court to demonstrate that Mr. Ralston in particular, and legislators in general, may not take advantage of the broad freedom they are given by legislative leave by disregarding the duty to report such leave to the court, when it is in, especially when it's outside of the regular session, and to avoid using their leave privilege to effectively put other parties in limbo for extended periods of time. On October 7th, 2015, Judge Stanley Gunter agreed and ordered that Speaker Ralston and his client were jointly obligated to pay plaintiff's attorney's fees associated with the motion of contempt, that Speaker Ralston and his client pay a civil fine in the amount of $500 for each and every week after August 15th that they failed to provide the ordered discovery responses, and finally, and I quote, in the event the outstanding discovery is not provided within 10 calendar days of entry of this order, the court will issue warrants for the arrests of the defendant and David Ralston as attorney for the defendant, with those persons to be incarcerated as a civil contempt until such time those persons demonstrate to the court that they have complied or will comply with the discovery obligations, unquote. Judge Gunter may not have questioned the speaker's need for legislative leave, but he held him in contempt and threatened him with arrest for what he did with it. But Mr. Richelieu was far from the only court officer who openly brought Mr. Ralston's use of legislative leave to the attention of the court. Mr. Richelieu was not the only one who drew attention to the court of Ralston's difficulty managing his caseload in a manner that was responsive to the orders of the courts, and in a manner that honored the importance of expedience and due process to our system of justice. My investigation noted over a dozen attorneys, themselves officers of the court, who issued formal complaints about Ralston's use of legislative leave, often multiple times, to the courts in four counties from 2002 to 2017, 10 of which occurring after Ralston became speaker, and 6 of which occurred in 2011 alone, the year following his election to Speaker. Statements made by opposing counsel include, in a 2011 objection to new counsel by attorney R. Ridgely Rary, in which Mr. Rary objected to Ralston entering a case 5 weeks before it was set for trial and submitting an out-of-session legislative leave continuance only 3 weeks later, Rary noted that both plaintiff and defendant were already competently represented. He further argued, quote, the movements can think of no reason for Mr. Ralston's involvement in this case other than as a deliberate delay tactic, unquote, and that, quote, Mr. Ralston's involvement has greatly prejudiced and harmed the movements in, to the extent that his honorable court must act to ensure that this case is heard without further delay, unquote. This was in January of 2011. The judge in that case, Judge Jason Deal, did not appear to intervene, as I discovered Ralston delayed this case at least 6 times from that date until roughly January of 2012. In a June 21st, 2011 letter to Judge Weaver in the Superior Court of Fannin County, in which he objected to Ralston's use of legislative leave, Attorney Simon Bloom stated, quote, "While plaintiff respects the busy nature of Mr. Ralston's position, plaintiff questions whether Mr. Ralston is honoring the spirit in which the legislative leave law was enacted. Based on the history of his use of this privilege in this case, if the court continues to honor it, this case will never go to trial," unquote. Mr. Bloom went on to state, quote, "Apparently, Mr. Ralston markets his ability to indefinitely delay the resolution of cases as a way to attract more clients," unquote. While the veracity of that comment hasn't been established, it's worth noting that Mr. Bloom's June 2011 statement to the court directly contradicts Ralston's February 2019 comments this year from The Well, in which he stated, quote, "I have never, never discussed legislative leave with a prospective client," unquote. In another incident in 2011, after multiple letters to Speaker Ralston dating back to 2008, in which Attorney John C. Edwards attempted unsuccessfully to get the Speaker to respond to discovery requests, Edwards appealed to the court in a February 2011 motion of contempt under circumstances nearly identical to those for which Ralston would be threatened with arrest 4 years later in Towns County. In his 2011 motion of contempt, Edwards informed the court that he had been trying to obtain discovery from Ralston's clients for 4 years. In a February 13, 2012 case status update to the court, Edwards informed the court of Ralston's, quote, "failure to provide court order discovery," end quote, and that there was, quote, "motion for contempt pending," end quote, and that Edwards was, quote, "unable to get opposing counsel to respond," end quote. Edwards informed the court of the same status again on September 25th of 2012, and yet again on February 18th of 2013. In his February 2013 update, Edwards informed the court, quote, "opposing counsel, Speaker Ralston, is on perpetual legislative leave," unquote. Records indicate the case continued to be delayed for legislative leave minimally through mid-October of 2013. A particularly compelling motion was filed by Attorney Susan Howick on October 14th of 2011. Following efforts to secure Ralston's response to long overdue discovery requests, Howick appealed to the court stating, quote, "the continued delay of this case has damaged and continues to damage my client. And my client requires the intervention of this court in order to avoid further delay in this matter," end quote. Howick asked the court, presided over by Judge Bradley, to, quote, "advise the parties as to the proper scope of the legislative leave law," end quote. It's worth noting that Ralston sent a letter to Howick's firm just 3 days prior to this on October 11, 2011, in which he stated, quote, "while it is true that the special session of the General Assembly has adjourned," parenthetically, it adjourned 41 days earlier, "my legislative duties have been ongoing and continuous since that time, and I continue to be on legislative leave. I am hopeful to be back in my office in early to mid-November, hopeful, so that I can complete responses to your discovery in the above case," end quote. As for this example, it's important to point out that I was unable to find any request from Ralston certifying to the Gilmer County Superior Court that he needed legislative leave from the date of his letter, October 11th, for roughly a month until mid-November. In effect, I believe he took the decision from the judge and simply informed Ms. Howick that he was issuing his own continuance on the requirement to respond to her discovery. Judge Bradley responded to Ms. Howick's October 14th, 2011 letter, roughly 3 months later on January 12th, by recusing himself. Instead of answering Ms. Howick's request for clarification of the legislative leave law, Judge Bradley instead informed Ms. Howick, in part, of the following. Quote, "Speaker Ralston of the House of Representatives, David Ralston, Speaker of the House of Representatives, David Ralston, defendant's attorney, has been a friend of the undersigned judge for 25 plus years, as was his father, the late Superior Clerk of Court of Gilmer County. For many years, Speaker Ralston's office was less than a half a block away from the undersigned's office. Undersigned and the Speaker have appeared together as co-counsel and opposing counsel in numerous cases," end quote. Judge Bradley goes on to suggest, and I quote, the court was unaware of the assignment of the above styled case until the plaintiff forwarded its motions to the court, having never received courtesy copies of any other additional pleadings. Now that the court is aware, and to avoid the appearance of impropriety, the undersigned judge hereby recuses himself, end quote. Seemingly contradicting that statement, Judge Bradley received legislative leave requests for this case from Speaker Ralston 4.5 months earlier on August 24th, 2011, and 6 months prior to that on February 8th, 2011. We're left to wonder if the judge knew he was assigned to the case when he approved these requests, or if he approved them at all. In yet another case, and on the same day Ms. Howard submitted her motion, Attorney David Lefkowitz was following up correspondence he sent in 2010 to a Fannin County court in which he was seeking responses from Ralston for overdue discovery as well. In his October 14, 2011 letter, Lefkowitz informed the court, quote, we have appeared a few times on a few calendar calls, but every time we do, Mr. Ralston, defense counsel, asserts that he is entitled to a continuance, unquote. Mr. Lefkowitz continues his letter by also stating, quote, justice delayed is justice denied, end quote. Peach Court online records indicate that Judge Bradley was recused from this case 5 months later on May 7th, 2012. If true, that recusal bears on the next example of a frustrated opposing counsel. Just 4.5 months after recusing himself from Ms. Howick's case, in which he delayed his quarter century, or in which he detailed his quarter century friendship with the speaker instead of answering Ms. Howick's request to clarify legislative leave, Judge Bradley was presented with a motion by attorney Paul Marochnik, in which Mr. Marochnik argued to disqualify Speaker Ralston as defendant's counsel. In his April 20th, 2012 motion, Mr. Marochnik argued that he had served written discovery requests to Ralston on August 12th, 2011, and that Ralston acknowledged as much 1 month later. Marochnik further states in Ralston's September 13, 2011 acknowledgement that Ralston claimed, quote, he was on legislative leave as a result of his duties with the Georgia House of Representatives and anticipated that this leave will continue to operate as a stay on all of his cases until October of 2011, unquote. I have a copy of Ralston's September 13, 2011 letter to Mr. Marochnik, but I was unable to locate any letter from Ralston to the courts requesting legislative leave for that period or a letter from the courts granting it. Mr. Marochnik went on to advise Judge Bradley in his motion that, quote, beginning in October 2011, I attempted to determine when Ralston would be able to meaningfully participate in discovery, end quote. Marochnik stated, quote, Ralston advised me in a letter dated December 29th, 2011, that he has been on legislative leave for virtually all of the calendar year and has been unable to respond to plaintiff's discovery requests, unquote. Mr. Marochnik concludes his motion by stating, quote, Ralston has continued to delay the case by failing to respond to discovery requests and by establishing an indefinite time frame to satisfy his obligations to participate in discovery. Therefore, this persistent course of conduct prejudices the plaintiff's interest, end quote. Mr. Marochnik asked Judge Bradley to issue an order removing Ralston as counsel, requiring defendants to obtain substitute counsel, or otherwise requiring defendants to participate in discovery to move this case forward. I share this example not only to demonstrate the recurring theme of Ralston failing time after time after time to honor court procedures, and on more than one occasion court orders, but also to highlight the judge's actions in this case. Unlike 5 months earlier with Ms. Howick's motion for clarification, Judge Bradley was swift to respond to Mr. Marochnik's motion. A little more than 2 weeks after Mr. Marochnik submitted his motion, on May 8th, Judge Bradley submitted his denial. The judge made absolutely no mention of the fact that he had recused himself from a case just 5 months earlier in Ms. Howitt's case, or that he had just recused himself the day before in Mr. Lefkowitz's case, both of whom were also protesting Ralston's use of legislative leave. Nor did the judge make any mention of the quarter-century friendship and working relationship he cited as justification for removing himself in Ms. Howitt's case. This pattern of behavior can be found in several other similar cases, but in the interest of time, I'll simply share the words of attorney Tanya Trumbull, sent on November 17, 2017, to Judge Mary Elizabeth Priest in Fannin County. Quote, despite the legislature not being in session, Mr. Ralston has once again claimed legislative leave. While I appreciate Mr. Ralston's service, it appears that Mr. Ralston cannot balance his legislative duties and his representation of his clients. My client was named as a defendant and has been unable to defend this matter due to Mr. Ralston's complete failure to prosecute this case, unquote. Quote, this continued delay is patently unfair to my clients, end quote. Opposing attorneys weren't the only ones who found their efforts to secure justice frustrated by, as attorney John Edwards put it, Speaker Ralston's perpetual legislative leave. Prosecuting authorities in multiple counties clearly took exceptions to the delays, specifically citing the passage of time in numerous instances as their justification for dismissing criminal charges against several of Ralston's criminal suspects they had previously sought to prosecute. And one of the most powerful examples of this, Frank Wood, assistant district attorney in Fannin County, motioned on March 23rd, 2015, to drop the prosecution of a criminal defendant accused of a misdemeanor. This was one of Ralston's clients. In his motion, approved by Judge Bradley, the assistant district attorney stated, quote, the constitutional right to due process, specifically that of the right to a speedy trial, requires that all cases brought by the state be resolved in a timely fashion. This right is heightened when the crime is charged as a misdemeanor. Delays in excess of 27 months have been found to be prejudicial against a defendant's right to a speedy trial. Due to the age of the present case, the Constitution demands that this case be dismissed. End quote. Ralston submitted at least six legislative continuances on this case, which stretched just shy of 6 years. Related, a little more than just 2 weeks earlier, a Gilmer County Assistant District Attorney dropped the prosecution of five of Ralston's criminal defendant clients on the same day, March 4th, 2015 to be exact. Collectively, those five cases, four DUIs and one disorderly conduct and an obstruction of a police officer, have been delayed by legislative leave continuances on no less than 25 occasions and ranged in age from just under 4 years to nearly 7 years old. The assistant DA used the exact same language in each of the motions to dismiss the charges, stating, and I quote, due to the amount of time that has passed since the case's exception, evidence has become stale. Witnesses have become unavailable. The recollections have faded. Continuing to pursue this case is not in the best interest of justice, nor the expenditure of public funds, end quote. In the span of just over 2 weeks, prosecutors chose to drop charges in six of Ralston's criminal cases, citing the passage of time and only the passage of time in every single instance. A vote aided by 31 legislative leave continuances, Ralston won. Ralston's clients won. Georgia lost. But as concerning as the past is in this matter, an equally concerning question must be asked about the future. My research suggests that Ralston has 32 active criminal cases in Fannin, Gilmer, and Towns County. Again, this is at the time that I pulled these records. Collectively, These cases have been continued for legislative leave a total of 150 times and are an average of 4.5 years old. The six cases we just discussed had an average age of 4.9 years of age. These cases are right in the window for dismissal due to the passage of time. So I'm not a lawyer, but it stands to reason that if the assistant district attorneys in North Georgia used age as the sole reason for dropping the prosecution of six Ralston clients whose cases were open for an average of 4.9 years, and if the ADA's assertion that delays in excess of 27 months have been found to be prejudicial against a defendant's right to a speedy trial is constitutionally accurate, then should we assume that Speaker's 32 active criminal cases are themselves on a clear path that leads not to the courtroom, but to dismissal as well? Finally, I want to take a moment to pause on one criminal case in particular. I looked very close at the State versus Key. I looked very close at Ralston's actions in this case and regarding his client. I looked very, very closely. And while most people who are familiar with Ralston's use of legislative leave and the recent reports of it are already familiar with this case, there are a few important details to it that have not been generally circulated. As a matter of background, Ralston's client was indicted in 2009 by Gilmer County for transmitting sexually explicit material to a juvenile under the age of 16 and enticing a child for sexual purposes also under the age of 16. Cherokee County also indicted Ralston's client, charging him with aggravated child molestation. Ralston's client was 29 at the time, the victim, both of which being under 16. In all, I identified a total of 44 legislative leave continuances that Ralston applied to his client's two cases. As many as 33 of those continuances appear to be out of session. In September of 2010, after his case was continued for legislative leave four times, Ralston's client was rearrested after being observed hanging out at a middle school football game. He was granted a new bond with the instruction that he would avoid any area where minors congregate. In December of 2012, his client traveled to Haiti and per online post, worked with children while on a Christian mission trip. Numerous photographs of Ralston's clients with children in Haiti were observed. By this time, Ralston had issued 18 total continuances on this case. As I said earlier, I'm not a legal expert, but I believe most of us would assume that his client would need permission from the courts to leave the country and that he was still under order of the court to not spend time in areas where children congregate. On December 19th of 2012, while in Haiti, Ralston's client was involved in a bad auto accident. 3 days later, the Gilmer Times Courier reported online that, quote, after getting the U.S. Embassy and state legislators involved, including House Speaker David Ralston, Derek Key arrived back in the States by Learjet this morning from the Dominican Republic, unquote. This is in the newspaper. Well, after 28 continuances to his aggravated child molestation cases, and over 6 years after indictments were issued, Cherokee County dropped their case 14 months later. Ralston's client was back in Haiti in 2014 and pictured yet again with teenage boys. I highlight this case for three reasons. Number one, the sheer volume of continuances in such an important criminal matter is simply staggering. Secondly, to illustrate that individuals charged with serious crimes whose cases are indefinitely delayed are able to conduct themselves in public in a manner that may not be in the best interest of public safety. And finally, given the extraordinary way in which Key has benefited from being a client of the Speaker's, I highlight this case in the hopes that the media and other appropriate agencies will look deeper into the nature of Ralston's relationship with his client and perhaps determine whose jet was used, who paid for it, and any other questions emanating from this event. I want to conclude by returning to my motivation for conducting this exhaustive review of Speaker Ralston's use of legislative leave. This is not now, nor has it ever been, about politics for me. It's about accountability. It's about transparency. And it's about truth. It's about standing firmly and courageously in defense not only of victims' rights, but in defense of what is moral and what is ethical. I'll close by reminding us all that great leaders use their power not to delay justice. They use their power to expedite justice. The people of Georgia deserve nothing less than that. Thank you for your time. With that, I know I owe you a response, sir.
Oh, and your earlier condition, you said that Mr. Ralston was the sort of sole arbiter of the court. And I'm just wondering, why would you say that, that he would supersede the judge's role in that courtroom?
The reason I made that statement is I didn't find an example where the court set a trial date where the judge wanted to have court, where he was allowed to if Speaker Ralston disagreed. I didn't see one instance at all where a continuance was requested and that continuance was denied.
You put a lot of facts out here in front of everyone here today. What's the worst part of all this in your mind?
There are victims of horrific crimes that have completely lost their faith in our system of justice because of the actions of one man. And as an individual that has fought for this country and for our Constitution, the idea that a fellow citizen is being denied justice out of convenience is disgusting to me. It's what motivated me to put this effort forward, and it was not an insignificant effort. I hope ultimately to hand this over to all the individuals here today. I've got soft copies of all the documents in front of me and everything I've shared with you, because I believe ultimately the public deserves to have this information, and the public deserves to determine whether or not Ralston was moral or ethical, not Ralston himself. Just a couple other questions. Yes, sir.
This question is for Representative Clark. What are you planning to do with this information other than turn it over to the news media? As a member of the legislature, do you have any intentions to do anything with this beyond that?
I'm hoping with the media before us that y'all would take this evidence and get it out there, because I think we're all on the same team. We all want justice. We are a voice for the people. And especially with the media, y'all have that platform. So I'm hoping we can go out there, get this out there, because I think it shows an absolute abuse of power. And I think it's all about the victims and letting them have their day for justice and their day in court.
There's been changes to the legislative leave law since these stories first came out. How does this impact the changes that the governor signs? I think this House Bill 502, wasn't it?
I think it was 502, 501.
There's changes to this legislative leave law. So what does this information bring to bear on the changes that have already taken place?
It's a big joke.
I mean, just in short, I want to stay on topic on the evidence and getting that out there. I do think the continuous law we did pass was very weak, very soft. It does not go near far enough. And I hope that from all this evidence, next session, that we will look back into this to say we need to tighten it up a lot. But again, I like to stay on topic on the evidence because I think that's what we need to get out.
Mr. Somerville, how much of this is on Speaker Ralston, and how much of it is on the judges for not taking control of this in their courtroom?
You know, the question ultimately comes down to an individual who exhibits bad behavior. Is it their fault or the people that don't correct them? And I think both are culpable. I did not find any example where judges held firm on this other than in Towns County with Judge Gunter. The behavior that got Speaker Ralston held in contempt and threatened with arrest was consistently found in other cases. What I did find, and I think it's important that a competent authority look closer into this, is very curious judicial behavior, recusals, inconsistent ruling and behavior in response to different motions, inconsistent response to this. So
I don't think it's fair to dilute the either conduct, but at the end of the day, the judge's need to control this behavior would not exist if it were not for the behavior itself. I hold the speaker solely accountable for his actions.
What do you think the speaker should do?
I think the facts speak for themselves. I think the facts speak for themselves with respect to that, respectfully.
And I would say, I mean, I think it's absolutely unbecoming of a speaker to use his position in that way for using it as a abuse of power. And for it, I think going back to what I said was he fashioned his power into a business model to enrich himself with little effort other than sending off hundreds of letters requesting special treatment from judges. I think that answers the question on what he's done.
Yeah, I want to clarify
Mr.
that.
Somerville, let me go back before, Johnny, before that, I mean, you presented a lot of facts here. There are a lot of options, I think, on the table for the speaker. Surely you have an idea of what you think those options you should take.
Well, I'll tell you this. When I first took a look at this, it was objective, and I was simply trying to determine whether or not this was even a possibility. As I worked through the volume and the mountains of data, obviously I started to form a bit of an opinion on this. I don't see how anybody can faithfully hold the office of Speaker of House of Representatives with this conduct in the public sector, number one. And number two is, it's beyond my grasp that the bar, the state bar in Georgia, would allow anyone to practice law like this. I think the Speaker should do the right thing. He's had 10 years in the role. He should resign. He should then immediately turn to his caseload, and I think that the courts or a competent authority should also look at his caseload and determine whether or not cases that have been languishing, some of which are now nearly 10 years, should be removed from him and given to competent attorneys.
Have you filed any bar complaints?
I wouldn't know how to file a bar complaint. I'm just a Marine.
I can't think of a better person to file a bar complaint.
Well, you know what? The day's early.
If another person were holding the job of Speaker of the House, who was also an attorney, would they face the same problem?
At the end of the day, and then we should probably wrap here, these are the conscious decisions of an individual. So not the decisions of a body of government. They're not the decisions of a role. They're not the decisions of a party. It's an individual making conscious decisions to use a law in ways that it was simply not intended to. So it's impossible, ultimately, to forecast how the next individual might behave. But I think there's reporting on this, and we have legislators that are lawyers, and no one has abused it to any level that we see here before us.
This is a pretty unique news conference, a pretty unique situation. Not many citizens do the kind of groundwork and foot, old-fashioned shoe leather work that you've done on this. Has anyone paid you to do this?
Wouldn't that have been wonderful? No, not at all. Not at all. So let me be especially clear about this. This was not undertaken on behalf of anyone at all. When I read the reports and I read Johnny Edwards' report, I was enraged and I was in disbelief. My business partner's here with me today. He knows I was fuming about it. And so I simply wanted to go take a look. At the end of the day, I realized what was being laid before me, that I wanted to stay completely objective. I wanted to stay completely removed from anyone who might try to influence or bias me. I did not work with anybody. I didn't receive any assistance. I didn't so much as let anyone make a photocopy, scan a piece of paper, or record anything. It was important to me that the integrity of this effort be unquestionable. And so at no point in time did anybody provide me anything other than moral support and then a few frustrated comments from my wife.
You could look at this data and you could interpret this as being an attorney who is just completely overwhelmed, who can't handle his caseload, who is just drowning in work. But you're saying that this is a conscious effort, that this is a business model, yes. That is, yes, something that he is doing intentionally with sort of a forethought. On what do you base that? How can you draw that conclusion?
I mean, in short, I base it on the evidence. I think it's clearly there when you connect the dots. You show that he's enriching himself with little effort, but sending in hundreds of letters to stay out of court, bill the hours, get paid,
and I believe the evidence is overwhelming. And I want the evidence to stand for itself on what he's done.
To follow up on Johnny's question, is it possible that, Mr. Ralston is incompetent as an attorney? And that that's the problem. That he just isn't taking care of his case. And I say that because every reporter in this room is covered lawyers who would fit that bill in our careers. It's not beyond the pale.
Yeah, it seems to me that question is probably best directed to the victims and some of his clients and other professionals that know the legal profession in and out. As I said before, all I wanted to do was record what was here, try to put it into a consumable package, and then hand it over to my fellow citizens and let them judge for themselves.
Derek, you're saying that this is not politically driven, yet you're sitting up here with a strong political opponent and the support of strong political opponents, Mr.
Right.
Ralston. How do we, who are watching this, juxtapose those two?
Very easily. If I have a press conference, nobody shows up. And the entire purpose of this was to leverage every available resource to me to get it out to the public. And I appreciate the fact that so many members came today that will afford us the opportunity. At the end of the day, this started because of the victims. And what I hope this does is act as an amplifier to their voices, and that their voices will carry further and louder and further and be supported by irrefutable examples of what they've been telling us all along. So the reason I'm up here today and the reason I'm sitting next to a member of the legislature is because he can get you to come here and I can't.
I wanted to clarify with you your numbers. You said 1,100 continuances?
1,091 instances where there's a document indicating that he had a case continued.
And what was the time period?
They begin, I looked at data, that's a great question. So I looked at records going back to 2000. The predominance of those numbers begin in 2006, and I've got a slide, and I'll show you the technical detail after this. But I'd say the overwhelming majority kick in from 2010 forward. So I've got the actual number, so I don't want to quote it, but I'll show you. So I would say I'll show you the actual number when we conclude here.
But it would be 2018.
The contribution to these numbers from 2000 to 2010 is nominal. Let me just put the slide up. Maybe that'll help.
So the majority of the cases will be in the last 8 years?
Overwhelmingly, the majority are. I want to say one small thing, just for y'all to think about. When y'all ask, there's a question, is he incompetent, or, does he bring on too many cases? Something just to think about, I think, was out there back when he was not the speaker. I know it did come out that he owed, I don't know the exact number, but something like $500,000 or something to the IRS. So I think he, and it's probably more than that, but no, somewhere around that. That I don't know if he resolved that, if he's paid back, what happened with that. But if you connect some of these dots, he needs the revenue to come in. He has things to pay. And again, I don't know how he resolved that, but that's the money you all owe the IRS. And so that's just something to throw out there for maybe. You ought maybe to look at and say, you know what, maybe he's adding on a lot more cases as speaker, but then he knows he can use the continuous law to not have to go do the work, just send in a letter, that's all he does. Just something to think about when you're trying to connect these dots with all the evidence that Derek has brought today.
What you're saying then is he's taking more cases than he can possibly handle, is that what you're trying to say in a more succinct?
I believe so. I mean, that is my belief, and from seeing the evidence, I think when you connect the dots, it shows that he can't handle all of these with his duties, but hey, you get paid, you can still have the client just send in a continuous letter and go about your day.
There's, as we conclude here, and number one, I will be available and we can take deeper dives down some of this data. There is one quick update, secondary to what I was doing. When the reporting first came out, one of the high profile cases was for a lady by the name of Jadon Carpenter. Who was allegedly physically assaulted by a three-time recidivist suspect. Speaker Ralston committed to tend to that and three other cases, so there were four high-profile cases that he said, I'm going to resolve these cases. As a result of this, I know they're high-profile, I'm going to resolve them before I take on any other cases. I found in the files last week that he voluntarily withdrew from her case and is no longer the attorney on her case, so he effectively delayed it for that period of time and now has left the representation of David Shell. I'm good to conclude?
20,000.
With that, when in the press conference, if you have any other questions, you can talk to us. Thank you again very much.
Okay,
thank you.
If we can add that there is one victim here from...
Cheryl Shin, absolutely. Yeah, Cheryl Shin made the trip down here, and thank you, Cheryl. I've had the humbling opportunity to communicate with her on several cases, or several instances, reviewed her file, and it's great that you're here.
Thank you.
Derek, what's the difference between the two colors? What are
the... The blue is in session, and I'm colorblind, that might be red. Orange is out of session. And again, I've got thumb drives with the PowerPoint, with all my statements, with all the scanned documents, and then the spreadsheets that built out all of this, and I will hand them out to everybody.
So it's approximately about 130 or so continuances per calendar year, if we get an average, and that's journalism.
I'll leave your math to you.
Ballpark. Is that too many?
I can answer that specifically when we conclude here. I've got the spreadsheet.
Well, go ahead and answer now.
Well, it's just math. I don't want to say a number and get it wrong, but I'll leave that up there and you can run through it. Those are what I documented. Okay?
I guess what I'm saying is when you break it down by year and you look at the big number sounds staggering. It's over a long period of time. You break it down by year.
Well, prior to being speaker,
too many continuances per year.
Well, the way I would look at it, Dale, is prior to being speaker, 36 was a lot, and a new lot kept getting redefined. There was a 128% increase in continuances the year he became speaker. There was a 76% increase the year after that. So there's a significant story to be told here. And incidentally, since we're talking about it, in 2012 to 2013, you see a drop off. In 2012 is when WSB started doing the story on Amanda Mosher. And in 2013, he was also being held to account for that during that cycle. So there's some patterns to this. And again, I'll give you the spreadsheets and I'll leave that up so you can calculate it. But
I think one other thing to remember, and I'm not an attorney, but I do understand that in some of these counties, you're not going to court, they don't hold court every day. They can't, on these cases, go in all through the month. Sometimes if you miss one, I hear on these rural counties, it might be 4 months.
Yeah.
So think about that also, that you might say, okay, this is 130 on average. Well, that's a lot because you're thinking about it's not, you have to wait 4 months if you miss that date sometimes. And I don't know all the counties, and I'm not an attorney, I don't know how the whole justice system works, but so when you add those numbers, you gotta think in those terms. Does he have to wait 4 months? So he's using that, maybe does it four times, three times in a year. That's just three times on that one case. And then he moves on to the next year. So it's just something to think about, I think, a little
bit. You know,
with
what
numbers.
Would be best is let's sit down and let me show you it mapped out because it's simply too staggering to walk through here.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you believe, what percentage of the continuances do you believe are legitimate?
There's no way for me to know that.
Isn't that important to know?
There's no, all I did was take count of the numbers. And there's some qualitative beat behind that we took from the letters, but I have no way of determining whether or not they're legitimate. Here's part of the challenge.
Would you say, Derek, that some are legitimate?
Well, one out of 1,091, one would hope some would be. Here's part of the challenge to the earlier question you had about the law and whether the new changes. What is a legitimate reason for legislative leave? What is it? Is it a speech at Rotary? Is it a constituent calls and says, I'd love to have breakfast with you, I have a policy question. Is it you need to research and read some documents because you're gonna be doing something next week and you don't feel ready? Part of the problem that we have here is there's simply no parameters established for what is a duty and obligation, number one. Number two is there's no check or balance. There's literally nobody that's rejecting any of this. But I'll bring it back to this.
There would be the new law, right?
Well, the new law doesn't establish that either. So the new law says, I believe, and I'm not an expert here, well, that is supposed to empower judges and prosecutors and victims to push back.
Should Georgia just do away with this legislative leave law?
I think Georgia should put extraordinary measures in place for periods outside of the legislature. During the legislative session, I perfectly understand why this might be. But that's a very limited period of time throughout the year. The real abuses and what really took my attention, I didn't even pay attention to what happened in session. It's in session, that's irrefutable.
what I looked at is all the opportunities out of session. And in this case, you know, it's north of half of these were out of session. So, again, I'd like to conclude if we can.
I'll say one thing. When you asked about the continuance, should it be allowed outside session, no other industry do we have continuances. So if you are a real estate agent, you know, you can't just use continuances. If you do, you are a CPA, you know, you can't use continuances, you know, in that way. So why should just attorneys have that one privilege? And you think about also, that's the justice system.
Yeah.
You have people who, it changes their entire life if you're putting these continuances and using them. So I think we need to have that talk that you just definitely use in session or special session. Besides that, I do not think absolutely there should be any continuances. Because if you can't juggle both, then you know what? Don't run for office. You're there to serve the people, to fight for the people. And so if you're an attorney, if you can't do both, and you can't fight for people on both fronts, then you need to give one up. Absolutely. So thank you all again for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jan Horn has videoed the entire thing, and the video's good. And it's available. I tweeted it out, the link to it, if you want to go back and look at this. And by the way, okay, talking about some of the questions Dale asked, the Republican Party had district conventions this past weekend. The 6th congressional district, the 7th congressional district, and the 11th congressional district all passed resolutions calling on David Ralston to resign. We're going to present it at the state convention in Savannah. So activists are upset. I mean, it's pretty telling that, you know, the 6th and 7th are purple districts, and the Republican activists calling him to resign.
You asked whether he was a good lawyer.
If any of the media wants our contact, Eric's in mine, I have a sheet and I can give it to you.
Excuse me.
And they got bragged about it. Oh, but thank you, son. But the
problem is, I talked to her the other day. She said it wasn't.
If the judges called it,
There was a lady in the back, so half of the norm was in the back.
Okay, so everything that's on that desk, my comments, all the supporting Excel spreadsheets are right. Daniel will be sending it to you. And then the PowerPoint.
Thank you so much.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm not sure.
This way, I asked it.
I'm looking around.
So,
Catherine Bernard is in the back.
And they want you to.
How are you? All right, I will make a few more of these drives.
No, I have. It's changed my tires on my car.
No, that's your
right. Oh, okay, thanks.
This is the added expense of this, but the whole point is to get the information out there.
Again, what all is on here?
Okay, so everything that's on that desk, my comments, all the supporting Excel spreadsheets where I manually put everything in, and then the PowerPoint presentation as well.
All of these documents?
All of it. Most of it's searchable. I don't want to be on. No, how do I childproof here?
I think someone did. I have an audio recording if you need.
Will you talk to my son?
Cases. So they bring out about 25 at a time. I go through. These counties want 50 cents a copy, and you've got 1,600 copies here. So these I actually just took pictures of because I didn't have the time. If nothing's automated, all it's nothing scannable. I'm convinced there's more. I just need a number of other things work for some reason. He says he has it. So I can drop
off.
Two was we saw.
That's how we find that was in. Okay, and then I'll come up and see you.
Wall Street Journal. Okay.
We need to talk about.
Yes.
We're talking.
Yeah, I'll give you a call.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Again, guys,
matter of fact, I'm about to leave you. I appreciate
it. Don't do that again.
Derek.
Is your contact info on the drop drive?
You know what's so amazing is how familiar this voice is.
It's awesome.
Thank you. I know your voice. I just never met.
Well, I'm good. Nice to meet you.
Derek Somerville. Yeah. Because I used one of your bits in a video that I made. And then I looped it on this issue back when I was just angry.
Oh.
So anyways, it's just an anecdotal side note.
So the story that I did after my channel.
Right. No, it was good though. It was great, especially.
Could I ask you a question by standing here?
Of course.
Summarize.
Of course.
You're standing here. Right?
Well, away from where all the other everything happened.
Okay. Am I allowed to have an advanced idea what you're going to ask?
So I'm just going to ask you what's the
But that's the volume weight connected to 10 orders.
Well, and the fact that, there was all this.
I didn't want to get editorializing this to make it take away from the data, but you know, when you look at Grant Austin, can you get it off your
screen? Sure. What's your name?
Nydia Tisdale.
Oh, you're Nydia. I'm Doug. Nice to meet you.
She gets understood.
You're Nydia.
Well, and I didn't want to editorialize in this because it takes away from the data, but you
Sure. What's your name?
Nydia Tisdale.
Oh, you're Nydia. I'm Doug. Nice to meet you.
She gets that a lot.
You're Nydia.
I think it's over that. I'm lovely to meet you.
Have him staying here and don't be over here.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're here and I'm here.
I'm on the wrong side of the camera. Dan.
How long, you were an FBI agent from?
Just 2 years in the early 2000s. So okay. Very brief period of time.
Appreciate it.
In the Atlanta office?
St. Louis, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You're not from there, are you?
I'm not. No. Okay. It's a good place to do what I was
you
doing.
You go ahead and. All right. Yes.
David, this should be you.
No.
I can see you later.
All right. Yep. I know your name. Say it for me anyway.
What? Derek Somerville.
S-U-M-M-E-R-V-I-L-L-E?
S-O-M-E-R-V-I-L-L-E, and Derek is D-E-R-E-K.
Okay. So if you had to summarize and say, holy smokes, I can't believe we discovered, after all this research, what we discovered, you would say what?
Well, number one, the sheer volume of it, I think when we heard 202, we were overwhelmed. I passed that number so quickly, and it became 500 continuances. And when we hit 1,000, I think, number one, the magnitude of it. I think the other piece that really hit home was the contempt order, which I think is pretty significant. But what occurred to me was that the same behavior that earned him that order of contempt was evident in so many other courtrooms. And so it's such a large volume of information to take out. But I'd say the volume of it and just the magnitude of some of the delays.
And repeated over a period of years in some cases, right?
Unbelievably so. In some cases, over 9 years. It's just an it's difficult to understand how to justify, in one case, 44 total continuances to one client over basically 9 years. It's as if there's no opportunity over that period of time at all to go to court. So I think, you know, what I tried to do as part of this is just to simply pull the facts and not be, not react to them, not respond to them, not be overwhelmed by them. But the numbers did catch me by surprise.
All right. See, that wasn't too hard, was it?
It hurt a little bit. stings a little bit.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You don't live, and you're not a fan of county.
No, I'm in Forsyth.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Were there any cases in Forsyth County?
There are. So there's a few counties that I know there are cases that I didn't get to. So Forsyth, Catoosa, Murray, Polk.
Oh, wow.
So I know those are going to be smaller areas, but the you know, Fannin and Gilmer and Union were kind of the big, if you need to take that, were the big ones. So, you know, the next step, although I think at this point the point has been made, would be to either go to those counties or encourage somebody else to finish this up, and that's why all this will go public and is public now, and then let other people jump on. You know, again, it's really simple. The public should be able to have our own conversation and not have it dictated by the individual who's the subject to the issue in the first place.
Yeah.
And that was always my point is, well, of course he's got a perspective that's particularly favorable towards him, and I just wanted an unbiased view, that's all. So it's good to share it, you know, that's for sure, and hopefully other people will take some interest.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it.
Thanks for the public-spirited work.
Yeah, well, I'm going to try to get some sleep. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming out.
William, thank you.
Yeah.
Nydia?
Nice to meet you, Doug.
You too.
She's documenting your movements.
Yeah.
Nice.
All right.
Because I think we're going to. Good questions, Dale. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and sorry, I don't know protocol. I don't know how these things work. So, you know, I didn't mean to blow you off.
I was under the impression that we were supposed to talk to you during the presentation.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. There's no problem. Quick question. Didn't you say there were two contempt of court?
There was more than one filing for motion for contempt. So there were other attorneys that tried to get an order of contempt. There was one order of contempt.
From the judge.
From the judge. And then there's at least another, because you know, obviously you have to put a motion for it.
Right.
So there's at least another attorney that filed to hold him in contempt.
A motion.
Right.
And that was 2011?
Yeah, I can.
No, we've got it on thumb drive. Mindy just said, when she was my partner, I don't know if you met her, she had mentioned that
there were two contempt motions. I said, no, I think there's only one.
Yeah, so that sounds so about right.
One judge's
right.
order.
One judge order and
order.
Right. And I would and then, when you look at that motion. Motions.
So it's one judge who said, I'm going to hold you.
Yeah, you're done. That's it. It's,
okay.
It's on
record.
But do you know off the top of your head how many attorneys filed
motions
filed, for contempt?
Well, I don't, but it's in the directory with that information. It's labeled, so you can get to it pretty quick. But there's probably 15 or 16 attorneys that basically threw their hands up at one point or another to the courts and said,
wow,
come on, this is not how this works.
I didn't realize it was that many.
Yeah. Yeah.
And did all
and
of
I tried to segregate those, so you'll find in those files extended leave. There's an extended leave folder. There's an extended, there's the upset counsel. There's, I tried to get everything.
Is
organized.
Bradley stuff in there?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, right?
Appreciate it.
Yeah, yes, sir. Thank you.
All right, I got to scoot off to Fox 5. I'm doing a podcast.
Perfect. So,
yep, good to see
okay.
you.
Okay, I'll talk to you in a bit.
Good job. Yeah, call me.
Thank
after you
him.
Rest.
Hey, how are you?
Good. Hey, William.
Well, Doc, the feed was interrupted several times at key points.
Thank you, Tom.
So, thank you for your work.
Let's get packaged up. Yeah, well, frankly, I'm ready for a break.
I think you take one for a while.
Yeah, you need to go take an actual vacation.
It's amazing how many people called me and said, I hope you survive.
Oh, wow.
Wow, that's a just going on record. Great spirits. Amazing how many people called me and said, I hope you survive.
Oh,
wow. That's a just going on record. Great spirits.
Hey, Derek, it was great to know you, man.
Yeah.
It was probably an inappropriate laugh.
No. I put it out there. I need David. I got to get this all wrapped up.
Yeah, let's do it.
Maybe we can debrief him. Let's see. That's cooling off, so let me let that do its thing. Yeah, all that documents, all the scanning, all the thing. And there was a time where I was dreaming about that stuff.
How many hours did you put in?
I mean, there are literally were days where I would roll out of bed, go right to my desk, and do it, and work on this until 2 in the morning. And I've always had that kind of crazy, you know, I'm going to do this until I get it done. But, I don't know. I don't know. A lot. An awful lot. So, well, hopefully it's just, it serves the purpose, which was to, you know, hand it over to the public. Let them have it.
Hey, Derek, it was great to know you, man.
Yeah.
It was
probably an inappropriate laugh.
No. I put it out there. Hey, David, I got to get this all wrapped up.
Yeah, let's do it.
Maybe we can debrief it. Let's see. That's cooling off, so let me let that do its thing. Yeah, all that documents, all the scanning, all the thing. And there's a time where I was dreaming about that stuff.
How many hours did you put in?
I don't know. I mean, there literally were days where I would roll out of bed, go right to my desk, and do it, and work on this until 2 in the morning. And I've always had that kind of crazy, you know, I'm going to do this until I get it done. But I don't know. I don't know. A lot. An awful lot. So, well, hopefully it's just, it serves the purpose, which was to, you know, hand it over to the public. Let them have it. Nydia, this can't be that interesting, me disassembling my electronics.
I'm usually the last one to leave the room.
Well, I followed your little run-in really closely, and I think it's great what you're doing. Really, really good what you're doing.
Well, it's not over yet.
Sorry?
It's not over yet.
No.
It belongs to the people. And
these books here until it's time to roll. I got to let that dish run, so I figured we'd go and debrief real quick.
Is here.
Are we here?
Yeah.
Oh.
Either way,
they always come back though.
Yeah, because I got to come back.
Thank you both.
Hey, thank
Excellent
you.
Excellent presentation.
Take care now. Yeah, if there's anything, by the way, I can ever do, reach out to me. We're connected.
Thank you. Okay. I appreciate that.